want no dead black woman. Oh, she do me wrong. Oh, she do me.
Hey everybody, I'm Woody Overton, your host for Real Life, Real Crime, the podcast. And I want to make a couple announcements today, and then we're going to get into our Ask Me Anything section that I promised the fans that we would do. And the announcements are, the first one is, I just want to thank everybody for rocking our podcast, man. We've been killing it. 45 countries, I think, from around the world now, and over 6,000 listens to the different episodes. And our private Facebook page has just passed 200 members today, actually, this afternoon. And I think, you know, less than 2 weeks ago, one of our fans and moderators, Rachel Franzen from Alaska, just created it less than 2 weeks ago. So we're up to over 200 members. And so give it a check it out and invite your friends, if you haven't already, if you're not already a member of the closed page, give us a request to be added and we'll add you. And it has more things on the page, you know, discussions with the fans, but that we also post different materials about each episode, such as photographs of the perpetrators and some crime scene locations and court documents and press releases and stuff like that. It's pretty cool. Check it out. And shout out to all our moderators on the page. Y'all are killing it. We appreciate you taking care of it. And also, y'all, we've been asked numerous times about producing more episodes, et cetera. And it just really takes a lot to do this and get it out on Friday. But so we decided to go with Patreon, which was recommended to us by one of our fans. And it's simply a subscription service where if you choose to, whichever level tier you choose to subscribe to, you'll get the bonus stuff that's on included in that tier. And it in no way is going to stop our regular fans from getting the regular Friday episodes of Real Life, Real Crime. You're going to get them and they'll always be free. But if you want to support, or I guess you would call it, or help us go bigger, which is what we're going to do. We're going to go bigger, and if you join that patron group, then of course you'll get whatever's promised, and I can assure you it'll be worth whatever the monthly fee is that you pledge. And we appreciate just, you know, even taking a look at it. So with that being said, we're going to get started with the questions that were submitted to us on our Facebook page by our viewers. Okay, so our first question comes from our pretty much a super fan, Cassie Wallace. And Cassie asked me, what case sticks with you the most and why? But Cassie, that's a real tough one to answer. Some of these questions y'all ask me are just tough. And anyway, I'll explain it to you. But as I can't say there's one that sticks with me more or the most. There are cases that I've done that are jumped to the forefront of my mind. But I can't tell you that one is above the other, right? So, and I don't want to do a spoiler alert. Different cases stick in my mind for different reasons. Like the Constance case, and we did in episode 1, it sticks with me because it was just such a mind-blowing, horrible thing, and we got to lock him up for the rest of his life, right? And but as far then, I have murder cases that I haven't done yet, and we're going to do in episodes that are upcoming. And each one of them sticks with me for a different reason. It could be the victim of the murder, or how they were murdered, or some, you know, it could be a cold case that I solved or something like that. So I can't really put it on there, but it's a good question. I just can't answer it with a specific answer. There's no way. But I can tell you this. If I put it on an episode of Real Life, Real Crime, then it sticks with me, and I think it's an important case. And whether it's, you know, so serious like the Constance case to the next one being Trust No One, which is just about as lighthearted of a podcast of telling about two murders as you can get compared to episode one, right, of David Constance. But so that's that one. Then let's go to the next question. All right, y'all. The next one comes from Kimberly Stowers, who is from Florida, and she's one of our administrators also on the private page, and just absolutely invaluable to our success. And we appreciate you, Kimberly. And she asked, me, on average, how many cases did you work at a time? That's a really good one too, Kimberly. When I was in general detectives, we didn't have a specialized division other than narcotics, right? So you had general detectives, and we worked everything from theft of a garbage can to homicides and in between. And naturally, a homicide would take precedence, but we were always working all the cases. So check this out. Every time a uniformed patrol officer would respond to a call and make a report that they didn't conclude right there on the scene, you know, if it was something stolen or a battery or an assault or whatever the case may be, it every single report they generated was sent to the detective division and assigned to a detective. So literally we would have hundreds of open cases each at one time, and it used to be almost comical because, you know, there's no way you could work such a caseload. And if I was reading a report that came in from a deputy, a uniform patrol guy, and it didn't have a suspect listed in the report, like the victim didn't know who stole their stuff and like that, I mean, they were lucky if they got a call back, right? But then again, the flip side of that is the squeaky wheel gets the grease. And if it was somebody that was friends with the sheriff or the chief deputy or what have you, then, you know, or somebody that actually called up and said, hey, what the hell's going on with my case, then you get called in, or, you know, they want you to go out there and make an effort on it, or even if it's just to soothe the victim, if you know there's no way in hell you're going to solve it because it's an unsolvable theft of a garbage can or whatever it may be. But so hundreds of cases, but naturally the squeaky wheel got the grease. And the other thing I would say on working cases like that is an APE. APE stands for acute political emergency. Those always got worked first, other than homicides. And that's anything that would end up on the news, or the maybe an internal affairs case that could, you know, be bad for the department. So, but that's it. Tons and tons of cases, but we always did our best on whatever it was that we were working. All right, and our next question is from Troy Perrette. Troy wants to know, where exactly do I live in Maurepas, Louisiana? And Troy used to be an officer with the Springfield Police Department under Chief Jones. And Troy, I probably did your polygraph. I used to do all their pre-employment polygraphs for them on the side, and I've known Chief Jones forever. But I live on the island, almost to the end of the island, and off of Paradise. If you're familiar with it, you know, you'll know where that's at. And we're probably six or seven places before the cul-de-sac on the island. Thanks. And our next question is, and so our next question is from, and I hope I'm saying it right, it's L-I-N-N-E-A-H, Linnea, maybe, and the last name's Tapper. And Linnea wants to know, why did you become a police officer, and was it your childhood dream job, and why did you quit? And then let me answer that part first, and then she has a couple more questions. So, God, I hope I'm saying your name right, but I always wanted to be a cop and or a law enforcement professional, and it's a, maybe I'll get into the details one day of all I ever wanted to be was like FBI, and I came close to going into federal law enforcement, and there's a whole nother story behind that, why I ended up local, but God does everything for a reason, and it worked out well, better than expected. And so, yeah, I guess, I've always liked the criminal mind and being a cop's all I ever want to do. And why did I quit? Okay, that's a good one. When I self-retired from the Louisiana State Police, I was at a headquarters in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and I was a criminal investigator too, and also a polygraphist, right? So a polygraph examiner. And when they recruited me to come be a criminal investigator too, I told them the only way I would do that is if I could continue my private polygraph business in which I conducted everything from relationship tests to criminal defense cases. And they said that I could, as long as it didn't interfere with any of the cases that I was actually working. So basically, I never did any type of defense work for Louisiana State Police or anything like that. But it just got to the point where my polygraph business and the consulting side of it was growing so much, and I couldn't afford to be a police officer anymore. As sad as that is, because I was making a really good salary with the state police, but that concluded it for me. And basically had to take a leap of faith to give up the guaranteed salary and career to go out on our own. And, my wife and I thought about it for a long, long time, and then we took the leap of faith, and we've been wide open ever since. We've been blessed, blessed, blessed. Okay, and Linnea, and you're going to have to let me know, Linnea, if I'm saying that right, also wants to know what made me start the podcast and what is my favorite podcast. Again, funny story, right? So I've written two books and published two books in the past, and I have tons of stories that I like to tell. And every night, when I'm putting myself to sleep, I'm telling myself another story in my head, and that's how I actually go to sleep at night. But my wife told me, we ought to start a podcast. And I didn't even know what a podcast was. Honest to God, I didn't. And she explained it to me, and she said, you have all the stories and people love to hear them, and they would just eat it up. I think, we need to do this. Let's take a shot and do it. And so that's why we did it. And obviously she was, as usual, she was correct. And it has been a success, and we've been very blessed. And as far as listening to a podcast, on my honor, I've never listened to a podcast ever until I listened to 1096 Crime Chicks, who hosts Amy Derrick. And I began to correspond when we first started doing this after we released our first episode. And she helped us out a lot and gave us some tips and stuff. And other than hers, I have gone in and clicked on a couple of them just to see. But mainly to listen to their openings and stuff like that. But I don't listen to any other podcasts. I could tell you my wife listens to Dave Ramsey every day when she's driving to her teaching job. But that's it. And probably the reason I never listened to a true crime podcast is it would be like, before I worked in uniform patrol, I used to love to watch Cops, right? And And then after I worked in uniform patrol, I didn't watch Cops anymore because it's kind of like going to work. But the true crime genre, I find that the ones that I have started to listen to, it's always, I don't want to say regular people, but people that have never been in law enforcement telling about cases that are, they're reading off the media. And I don't really get that. But so I'm just, you know, doing my own thing, telling the stories, which I've always said law enforcement is the greatest show on earth, and the, you know, and the truth is stranger than fiction. All right, and our next one is from Miss Christine Hernandez, who's another one of our moderators and is very active in making our page such a success. And Christine wants to know, she said, I just have to tell you, Woody, I love your accent. And have you ever lived anywhere else besides Louisiana? Actually, yes. I've lived all over the United States, but I am, you know, born and raised in South Louisiana, and it will always be home. I've lived, geez, y'all, I just got rid of an apartment in Dallas from the, and came back to the island full time on that. I just travel a lot with my work. But I lived in Tennessee for a period of years. It would be my longest stay anywhere else. I lived in Florida for a short period of time and spent some time in Texas. But the accent is probably just, you know, a combination of where I'm from in South Louisiana. And the next question is from Miss Cassie Wallace. And Cassie Wallace is another one of our administrators on the private page and a huge supporter. Cassie, we appreciate you. And the question is, do you plan on doing any live episodes or even shows, meets and greets, or crime con? But Cassie, you're going to make me let the cat out the bag early, but we have already registered for Crime Con this year, and we will 100% be there. And it's in New Orleans, so it's right down the street practically from me. And we're going to have a booth, and of course we'll do meet and greets and, you know, sell merchandise, etc. And yes, I plan on doing live shows, especially for our patron members and in the tier groups, as you know, because you joined it, which we'll give you a shout out and explain more about that to everyone else on Friday's episode when we release it. But yeah, we're going to do everything we can do, put ourselves out there and meet the fans, and thank y'all for the support. And our next question is from Miss Rachel Stone. And Miss Rachel wants to know, what is the one case you worked on that you feel exceptionally proud of? I'm so keen for this episode. Well, Rachel, I'm really proud of a lot of them, right? And it's just like when I was asked earlier about which case sticks out of my mind the most, I can't put a label on which one stands to the front of my mind more than the other, but there are so many that I'm so proud of, and you're going to hear every one of them in the episodes. If it's in a main episode, if it's on a regular Friday episode, I'm proud of it. But like I said, it's for different reasons. And, you know, episode one, David Constance, obviously career pedophile, locking him away when they just wanted to give him another slap on the wrist. Episode two was more about how I can use the polygraph in a kind of weird, funny way that case broke out. And episode three is getting, you know, the dirtbag wuss to confess and get him to respond to the news and say, yeah, I did it, I'm guilty, right? And you know, but that case stuck with me. I mean, I guess the brutality of it. But it's just so many of them that I'm proud of. And look, y'all have some cases coming up that are really going to upset you. And so just stay tuned. I promise you one thing, none of the episodes will be boring. there's some of them that are going to have to be longer than an hour, and they're going to have to be broken up because they're so detailed, including the next one that we're doing. So just stay tuned, Miss Stone, and we'll see. And our next one, y'all, is from Chris-Shan, S-H-A-N-N, and the last name Hayes. And Chris wants to know, are there any unsolved cases that haunt you? I don't have any unsolved cases, Chris, that haunt me. I have a few cases that I solved that I got confessions in from the bad guy, that I have more evidence that ties them to the crime, and they were not prosecuted. And those are the cases that haunt me. And they're not prosecuted because the prosecutor didn't want to take the chance on the cases. And I'm going to go in depth on those cases too. I'm not going to hold anything back. District attorneys love to say they have a 98.5% conviction rate when it comes to election time. And that's because 94% of their cases, they plead out, but though, as far as unsolved, I don't have it. And I'm not conceited, just convinced. I don't have any unsolved. I do have some that should have been prosecuted that weren't. I'll let you know when those episodes come up, because you'll know at the end of the episode, because you'll be as pissed as I was. And the next question is another question from Linnea Tapper. I mean, again, I hope I'm saying your name right. And she wants to know, how did you end up a polygraph examiner? Was it something you wanted or just something the department needed? I think it was more of what the department needed. And the chief of the detectives at the time had been trying to get the sheriff to approve for a polygraph examiner for years. And in fact, was pushing very hard for one of the older detectives to get it. And I was fortunate enough that the sheriff and the chief criminal deputy picked me. And it's kind of a big deal. The school is that I went to was the Texas State Police headquarters, and the same curriculum that the Department of Defense Polygraph Institute teaches. It's the only school in the United States of America where senior law enforcement examiners from around the world come to, and that you have to be senior law enforcement to get into it. The sheriff asked me, of course, jumped at the chance, and what a ride it's been, right? And what a blessing. And Kimberly Stower, a dear friend, has another question, and it's, do you listen to any podcast yourself, and what is this one case you follow that you did not work in? Kimberly, no, on the podcast, except for 1096 Crime Chicks. That is the only podcast that I've ever actually listened all the way through. And yesterday they just released their, I think it was episode 9, and it told of a girl, a murder that I didn't know about, and from Baytown, and the strange behavior of the bad guy, etc. But so that's it. 1096 Crime Chicks, and the that is the only thing, one that I've ever actually listened all the way through. And as far as a case that I follow that I did not work in, believe it or not, the one I follow pretty much all the serial killer cases throughout my career, right? And I love doing criminal profiling, etc. And one of the first ones that I started with was the JonBenet Ramsey case, and I always thought it was fascinating, and actually was in a homicide class where we did everything from dissecting the handwritings and the letters to the witness statements and stuff like that. So that one was always interesting to me. And believe it or not, I always liked the Natalie Holloway case and the disappearance. Of course, we know who did it now and everything, but the body never being found. But that's it. That's the ones that I follow the most, but I know all of them. I mean, I've actually studied all the greats. I mean, Ted Bundy, John Wayne Gacy, Son of Sam, even the Unabomber, right? I've read all the books and watched all the documentaries you could imagine on what I call the good bad guys, which are, you know, the big killers. And the final couple questions, y'all, are actually about my wife, and it's from Cassie Wallace and Kimberly Stowers. And I was up, we were gonna actually gonna do include her today, and then it ended up not being able to happen. But what we're going to do is we'll have a question and answer session, or a ask me anything. I love that term, right? When I was researching the patron stuff, they instead of Q&As, what we used to call Q&As, question and answer sessions, they call it an AMA, a ask me anything. So we're going to do that and include it in the patron package a little bit later on, but we should, you know, appreciate it. And I can tell you, what Cindy listens to, I already stated earlier, is Dave Ramsey. And I know that because my son tells me about it. And, you know, she makes the kids listen to it and what have you. But I'm not sure if she listens to anything else or not. And that's it. But we'll get her on at a later date, and y'all can pick her brain. And we're going to do some live shows like that for the patron tier groups, and even some Facebook Live and all that good stuff. And you have to remember, we're still pretty much virgins at this, right? And on the recording and the editing. And obviously, we've improved since the first episode, the volume of it, although not everybody had the issue. Some people had the issue where they couldn't hear it, said it was hard to hear. And I think we cleaned that up. But my wife is the one that does all the editing. And I'm not computer savvy, never have been. And so she does all the technical side of the stuff. So, and we'll get into that, and I promise those episodes live and whatever, we'll get with y'all ahead of time and see what it is that you want to do. But I really appreciate each and every one of you, and hope you enjoy this, and hope I answered some of your questions. I know I was kind of vague on some, but some I just couldn't answer. But we appreciate your support, and we appreciate everything that you've done, you sharing and making it big, y'all. It's just crazy, crazy good and crazy fun. And I'm like a crack addict checking my lips and stats every 10 minutes or whatever, right? See how many downloads have happened. But it's all made possible because of you, the fans and the listeners. And we love y'all and we appreciate you. And let's keep rocking it, right? Thanks again. And I'm Woody Overton, your host, Real Life, Real Crime, the podcast. Thanks.
Sugar in my car.